sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing.
First Noel.
The first Noel, the angels did say, was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay, in fields where they lay keeping their sheep.
Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the heavens.
I absolutely love this time of year, and I've asked a little helper of mine to come up and help. This is my oldest daughter, Avery. And what we do in our church as we look forward to the arrival of Jesus is we do something that has become just a tradition here. We light the Advent candle. And I love today because we get to light the candle of joy. So Avery and I are going to come over here, and we're going to light this real quick. I'm going to do it because I don't trust her with fire yet. And Avery here, she's holding our arrival booklet. And one of the great things about this is something that you can do as a family. You can come together. You can light the candle. There are songs in there that you can sing. I know that Avery and my daughters love singing Christmas songs together. So she had a Christmas concert just earlier this week. And I was seeing it, and I'm like, wow, she knows these songs really, really well. It's because we're able to sing them as a family. And so I wonder today, just as we are singing together and we're diving into the scriptures, can we remember, as we've lit the candle of joy, that the reason we can have joy is because Jesus came. So I'm going to read a scripture. It's in Luke chapter 1, starting verse 26. It says, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a village in Galilee, to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, greetings, favored woman. The Lord is with you. Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. Don't be afraid, Mary, the angel told her, for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be very great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. And his kingdom will never end. That is why we can have joy this Christmas season, because Jesus came. Now I'm going to ask my daughter Avery to pray for us. Lord, thank you.
Lord, thank you.
For being our source of joy.
For being our source of joy.
Thank you that even.
Thank you that even
in times of trouble,
you are with us.
And your joy sustains us.
Fill us with your joy.
Fill us with your joy
this Christmas season.
This Christmas season.
So that we reflect.
So that we reflect.
Your love.
Your love.
Peace.
Peace.
Hope.
Joy to others.
And joy to others.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, at the end of our service, we're going to do something that we always do, where we are going to give to many projects that are going on all around the world to people less fortunate than us. And I would ask you, during the rest of this service, would you pray, would you consider how you might redirect some of your Christmas giving this year? But right now we have a special treat, and our children, our kids, are going to lead us in giving. So I'm going to invite our kids to come forward as the band sings one more time.
Grab a cup of coffee or some tea, say hi to the people next to you, and we will be back in just a moment.
Good job, guys.
That was a whole moment.
Love it.
Joy to the world, the Lord is born. Let earth receive her King. Let sing, and heaven and nature sing, and the heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature. Truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of
Stanwood Foursquare. My name is Jed Dorsey, if we haven't met, and I'm just a normal dude that goes to church here just like you. A couple weeks ago, I wasn't sitting on my porch like I am here, but we were down in Mexico. My family and I, wife and daughter, we went down with a team from the church. And so I just want to share a little bit about what that was like and what we gained from it. First, I think we really gained a new perspective. Anytime you travel, you see new things, you experience new things, it expands your world. And it's super fun, but this is even more special than just traveling because it's a mission trip. Like you're going and you're building a house for people who need it. And you're going with God's people who are already there at the YWAM base, and they're connected to the community. They know what's going on. And so you really get this sense of being part of what God is already doing, and you're just able to come in and help in a very specific way and see this kind of quick result from your labor. Over 2 days, you build a house and you hand off the keys to this family, and you see that their life is going to be changed because of it. And so your perspective changes, because when you come back home, you're more thankful. Man, we gave them basically a glorified shed, but they were so grateful and humble and content with that. Why would I come back and complain about my house? Because my house is like a mansion compared to them. So that's first thing, perspective change. Second thing is you're gonna connect with a team of people from the church, and it's gonna be like building friendships like you can't do on a Sunday morning. You know, you gotta get in and work together and eat together and drive in the bus together and all this stuff, and all of a sudden you realize like you gain friendships that would take years if you were just kind of sitting next to each other in a chair for an hour on a Sunday, because that experience bonds you together. So I feel like those are the two biggest things that we took home from that. If you're somebody who's kind of like sitting out there wondering, would this be a cool thing? If this is even interesting to you at all, I highly recommend that you come up and talk to somebody like who's gone. It's so It's a really life-giving experience, and it's actually a wonderful place to go. The YWAM base there is super safe, and it's honestly, it's really beautiful, and it's right across the street from the beach. And it's just like, it was way, in some ways, it was just an easier experience than I thought it was gonna be, because everything's set up for you. You don't have to figure out a bunch of stuff. You go and they have it ready for you. You get to eat, sleep. They take care of all that stuff, and you just do the work, and you get the joy of seeing what God is doing in a family's life. So, highly recommend it. Thanks for listening. Have a wonderful rest of this Sunday.
So what you're seeing now, these are dates of our trip this coming year that you are going to be able to go on. So if you have any questions at all, please find someone on staff. As Jed said, find somebody who's been, and we are more than willing to tell you all about those trips. And I got to tell you, this is just one of those projects that I get really excited about as we come towards our arrival offering at the end of service. That's one of these projects that is in here, and actually, the youth of Stanwood Foursquare, we give towards a project every year. And this year, we got them all excited because we said for the first time, not only are we going to give to a project that's going to get done, but we're going to give to a project that we're going to go and be a part of. So in January 2024, we're going to be taking another youth team down to Ensenada, Mexico, and they are going to build a couple of houses for a family that is in need. And I'm so proud of them. Our youth have already given over $1,300 towards houses in Ensenada, Mexico. So we are so, yeah, that's great. We can give that up for them. But what I want to encourage you to do during this service, would you pray and would you consider how you can redirect some of your Christmas spending this year to give to some of the most poor and needy around the world? There's going to be envelopes in the seat back right in front of you that you can give in. And then you can also read in the arrival book about all of the projects that we have. Now, I also want to tell you a little bit about what's going on in the life of the church. First off, a week from today, it's kind of a big day. Does anybody know kind of what next Sunday? Oh, it's Christmas. Yeah. Yeah, we love Christmas around here, but we are going to be moving our Christmas Day services online. So if you show up, we won't be here because we are going to be online. But we definitely want to invite you. We have several Christmas services on the 23rd and 24th. It is going to be a great time together that we can remember and rejoice the coming of our King Jesus. And then we also want to let you know that on January 1st, the following Sunday, we are going to have a family service, just one service at 10 a.m. So put that down on your calendar. I know that we're messing with the times a little bit, but I promise you we will get back to normal right after that. And then we just want to say thank you so much for your generous giving, not just your arrival giving, but the giving that goes on all year. We could not do the things that we do without your giving. So if you came prepared to give today, you can give, drop your gift in the box before you leave, or you can give online or through our app. And then if you missed any of this, because I just threw a lot of information at you, be sure to go to our website, check out our app, so that you can get all the information you need. And now will you turn your attention to the screens?
Well, good morning and Merry Christmas. It's hard to believe Christmas week is this week. If you haven't got presents yet, I think the shipping deadline is quickly approaching, if not past, so you're in trouble because malls don't exist anymore. So what happened to the premise of all the 90s films? They're all gone because malls don't exist. What are future generations going to understand about shopping? Well, this week as we continue in our Advent or Arrival series, we're talking about this word joy. And joy is one of these themes that the church has celebrated for generations when it comes to these words, these concepts that we celebrate at Christmas. We've talked about love. We've talked about peace. We've talked about joy. And joy is this idea, this biblical concept that I think is just awesome. How many people would want to be happy? Right? I've only met a couple people in life who want to be grumpy, and most of the time they're working hard to be happy, but they just don't know how. And so we have to like practice being happy. Okay, so we're going to do a little exercise here because being happy is really great. So I want you to turn to your neighbor and frown at them. Just be like, just scowl, shake your head a little bit. How does that make you feel? Like, I feel sad and hurt. All of our college students are back and they've just hurt my feelings. Like, so excited. Okay, now I want you to turn to somebody, and this is the secret. Raise your eyebrows and smile at somebody. Be like, hey, how you doing? Just turn. How does that make you feel? That was a little creepy right there, but right? Most of the time, it makes us feel really good. Right? We want to be happy. We want to be filled with joy. Christmas is this great time of joy and celebration. The prophetic messages of Isaiah, a great joy, which will be great good news for all the people. The angels tell the shepherds. It's joy all around. And joy to the world. All these songs. And then, you know, there's the great songs. It's the happiest season of all. As lounge room singers sang, there'll be mistletoe-toeing and loved ones are something, and chocolate and marshmallows all around, right? It's the happiest season of all. We all want to be happy. We all want to have these amazing things. And the scriptures are filled with, boy, the promise of God is going to give us joy. We spent all summer of 2022 in the book of Philippians, which is this book, this writing of the Apostle Paul to the church in Philippi about how you can have joy in the midst of all the challenges we face in life. A few weeks ago, I was at a leader training with some pastors, about 35 of us in the room, and we got the privilege to have this big Hollywood producer. I didn't really know who he was. His name's Ralph Winter. He's a Jesus follower, and he joined us virtually to this meeting, and he started telling us the movies that he'd done. I didn't know who he was, but I'm like, I've seen that movie. And he started talking to pastors about how do we tell good stories? Because, like, that's my job, right? Jesus told stories. What we're supposed to do, the gospel is the greatest story ever told. And this Hollywood producer, who's a great follower of Jesus, he started telling us about why we need to tell great stories. And we were asking questions. It was a really interesting time together. And somebody asked, like, why is the scriptures endured? Why has the Bible lasted? And he goes, oh, yeah, I can tell you why. Because the Bible is filled with dark stories. And I was like, what does he mean by that? And he went on to say this. He goes, that I think sometimes we think that the scriptures or the story of God is like a fairy tale where everything turns out really well. But he goes, you know what my life is not like? My life is not like a country song backwards where my truck gets uncrashed, my dog comes home, my beer gets unspilled, the girlfriend comes and apologizes. Right? No, that's not what happens most of the time, right? Life's tough. Difficult things happen. And even when we talk about what it means to be a follower of Jesus, it's not this idea, if you say yes to Jesus, it is Care Bears, unicorns, and I don't even know, Blue's Clues. I don't even know what the newest cartoon is anymore. Right, but we can have this idea, everything's gonna be great. No, that's not the promise of Jesus. That's not the promise of the gospel. It's not the promise of God. The idea is this, is God says this, is I'm gonna send my son Jesus into the midst of the chaos of the human experience, into the midst of the brokenness, into the midst of sorrow and pain. And the promise is this, is that God will be with us. Because if you've lived for a hot minute, the psalmist says this, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Anybody ever been in the valley of the shadow of death? And you know, Christmas, we're supposed to have all this joy and happiness, but you know that Christmas is also one of the most challenging, emotionally difficult times for people? Because we miss loved ones. We recognize the pain in our own lives. And it can feel like the valley of the shadow of death. But the promise is this, God will be with us. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, God, you're with me. His promise of his presence with us, Emmanuel, which means God with us. And the story of Christmas is about the birth of God's son, Jesus, who comes into the world to change everything, to restart creation. Jesus is called the second Adam, where God says, I'm gonna redo everything. I'm gonna bring hope and redemption to humanity who've gone through tough stuff, and it's gonna be a God who's with us, God who is present with us. And it's about babies being born. We all know that, you know, the story of Christmas is about the birth of Jesus. You know that the Christmas story, there's also another baby who's born? Extra credit, who knows? Anybody know the other baby's name? Like two people, Sunday school awards, right there. There's another baby that's born, is John the Baptist, who's later known as John the Baptist. And if you have had children, children produce big feelings. I don't know how else to describe it. But do you remember the birth of your children? Like, it was so exciting, especially your first child. Do you remember being freaked out? I've told you this story before, but and I've told my wife before, but when we had our first son, I just felt so unequipped as a father. Every time Anna and our son Ben would get in the car and drive off, I would just think that they're gonna get a car accident, Anna's gonna die, and I'm gonna be responsible for this baby. So in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, like, who can I marry to help me raise this child? Because this is gonna happen. Right? That's the sickness of my own human condition. Anna knows about it. You don't need to tell her after service. We've gone through therapy, it's good. Right, but that's just like, I don't know what to do. How am I gonna raise this child on my own? What am I gonna do? The excitement and the joy, but the terror. And then as your kids grow, anybody ever lost some sleep over some teenage children? Are they going to make good choices this evening? Where are they? Even before cell phones, I don't know where they're at. God be with them. Right, it can be challenging, all these things of children. They cause the greatest joy, but I think also the greatest pain and sorrow in this story of John the Baptist. It's a story that is a story of joy, and God shows up, and he does a miracle in this man named Zechariah and his wife Elizabeth. And it's a story of great joy. And so I want to spend some time reading this today. And in Luke chapter 1, we're going to read about Zechariah and Elizabeth, the parents of John the Baptist. Luke 1, starting at verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. And so they played a specific role. Zechariah was a priest. This was a specific, unique assignment in the nation of Israel. These were people who were part of the tribe of Aaron, and they ministered to God on behalf of the people. And so they were chosen to go and offer sacrifices to God in the temple. And Zechariah was chosen for a special assignment, a special of duty. And then verse 6 says this, both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees, and they were blameless, but they were childless because Elizabeth was unable to conceive, and they were both very old, right? So let me interpret both very old, postmenopausal, okay? So the time for childbearing has come and gone. That season is over, and so here's we're gonna hear a story of joy, but you know where it starts? It starts in barrenness. Starts in barrenness. So if you're taking notes, we got three words today. They're gonna start all with B so we can remember. But barrenness. And in the first century and throughout the scriptures, if you were unable to have children, it was a great source of shame. It was, there wasn't much worse as you were kind of excluded from life and culture, and the inability to have children, you didn't have a future secured. There was no retirement plan. Your children were your retirement plan. And so there was a lot of challenges in the midst of this. But even in the midst of this, Zechariah and Elizabeth, what does the scripture say is that they were both righteous. They lived rightly before God. They obeyed all of the Lord's commands, and they were blameless. And what it shows to me and what I see here is they did not have a contractual relationship with God or a transactional relationship with God. And so many of us, this is where we find ourselves, because I've done this too. Have you ever prayed a prayer? Like, God, if you do this, I'll do this. Anybody ever been in the hospital? You get a call. You say, God, if you'll heal, if you'll intervene, I'll go to church every Sunday. I'll give, I'll pray, I'll be good. I'll do these things. And often our spiritual lives can be boiled down to this transaction that says, God, if you do this, I'll do this. But Zechariah and Elizabeth are this beautiful picture of a non-transactional relationship with God. Because my guess, these were righteous, faithful people, blameless. And my guess, every time they went to church and it was prayer time, they're like, hey, let's pray. What are the needs in our lives? And they would come and they'd pray, we long to have a child someday. We pray that God would intervene, that God would do this in our lives. And years after year after year after year after year, they prayed and they longed and they said, God, would you please? And the season of life had come and gone, and they were, when the Bible says very old, that's like an emphasis on very old. And it seemed like that season had gone. And all their prayers had fallen on the deaf ears of God. And in their barrenness, in their disappointment, in their shame, they're heroes to me because they were still righteous and blameless, and they followed all the commands of the Lord. I know we're all waiting for something. I know we're all hoping and longing for God to do something in our lives, some miracle, some point of shame. Can we be like Elizabeth and Zechariah? God, even if you don't come through, even in this place of deepest hurt, of deepest pain in my life, the barren places where it doesn't seem like there's any fruit, there's nothing going on, can we just still be faithful and righteous and blameless in the midst of all of our disappointments? Because if you don't know this, I know this is a really exciting Christmas message, but you will be disappointed in life. There will be pain and sorrow, things that will seem so unbearable. You think, how can I even get through this? I don't know, but we'll get through it. And it's in those points of the valley of the shadow of death, in the darkest places, the places of barrenness and pain and sorrow and grief. I would love that one day it was said of me, it was said of us, man, God didn't answer their prayer, but they were faithful and blameless and righteous, and they followed all the commands of the Lord. And in the midst of Zechariah's ministering to God, doing his priestly duty, an angel shows up. And he's shocked. In the place where he was literally in the presence of God, Zechariah was shocked that God actually showed up and talked to him. And the angel says, Zechariah, you're going to have a child. And he's like, yo, you don't understand. My wife is, like, I'm old. She's very old. Like, this isn't good. This is beyond the season for us. And he says, no, it's going to happen. And he says, Zechariah, in fact, because you didn't believe, you're not going to be able to talk until this child is born. And so everybody's getting concerned because where Zechariah was, it was like the presence of God. And if you didn't go in right, like people would die in the presence of God. So they're like, Zechariah's taking a long time. What's going on? He's not coming out. And he comes out and he can't speak. And everybody's like, whoa, this guy just had an encounter. What's happened? And he goes home. And when, verse 23, when the time of his service was complete, he returned home. And after his wife, Elizabeth, became pregnant for 5 months, she remained in seclusion. The Lord has done this for me, she said. In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. It's never too late. Don't give up. Don't give up. Even when it seems like that season of life is over, like I don't even know if I want you to answer my prayer now that I so long for, God. We're too old for this. But God answers their prayer in their place of brokenness and shame. And she says, the Lord has done this for me. In these days, he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people. God meets them in their biggest point of shame and longing. And in the midst of this, the story's going on, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, is visited by an angel and says, you're a virgin and you're going to give birth to a child. There's angels and babies happening all over the place to women who shouldn't be having babies. Miracle upon miracle. And Mary hears about this and she goes and she visits her cousin, her relative, to celebrate with her. And at that time, Mary got ready and hurried to the town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed what the Lord would fulfill his promise, that he would fulfill his promise to her. All these supernatural things are going on. I love this picture, this illustration of Elizabeth, who's in 5 months in seclusion. She's old. She's probably on bed rest being pregnant. And Mary comes and visits her, and when she hears the voice, the baby leaps for joy in her womb, and there's supernatural things going on. She's filled with the Holy Spirit. All these amazing things are going on. And I was thinking about this week. I wonder if there's something here for us to learn when we think about joy. That joy in Elizabeth's life was this child that was in her womb that she was developing and growing. And I wonder if God, see, we love this idea of joy, but I think most of us, we want joy like as a fully grown in all of its expressions. There was a ridiculous Saturday night, skit years ago, and Will Ferrell is born as a full-grown man. And it's this bizarre thing. He's like, hey, mom, thanks for birthing me. Like coming and having a conversation with mom. And I think that's what we think about when we want joy. We want joy in the fullness of its maturity. We want joy in all these things. But I wonder if like that baby John that God put in Elizabeth's womb, I wonder if God gives us the seed of joy. And there's a responsibility we have to nurture it and to give it an environment to grow. God gives us the gift of joy, but it's our responsibility to grow it. I think we have a picture here. I remember when we were having kids and they compared the baby to the size of fruits and vegetables. I just got hungry every time we went to the doctor. And week four, the baby is the size of a poppy seed. Week eight is a raspberry. Week 12 is a plum, an avocado, a banana. I never saw the corn one, an ear of corn, an eggplant, a squash, a papaya, and then finally a pumpkin. And I think most of us, we want a pumpkin. We want joy, a full-size pumpkin of joy. But I can tell you this, that God has given each of us a poppy seed of joy. Are you gonna be accountable and responsible to let it grow and develop and become the gift that God fully intends for us to have that's deep within us? We have a responsibility to nurture the joy that God has given so that it becomes a part of who we are. So in the midst of our barrenness, in the midst of Elizabeth's barrenness, God shows up, and then it comes time for birth, our second B word, birth. When the time for Elizabeth to have the baby came, she gave birth to a son. Her neighbors and her relatives heard of what the Lord had shown, that the Lord had shown her grace, had shown her great mercy, and they shared in her joy. When everybody finds out that Elizabeth has given birth to this child, they're excited for her. They celebrate with her. Their friends and their neighbors shared in the great thing that God has done in them. And that's what we should be. We should be people of joy who celebrate when it's time to celebrate with people. But here's another thing I'm gonna confess, that sometimes I'm a little sick, and I think this happens to you too. That when I should be happy for people, when I hear that something great has happened for them, sometimes I get a little jealous. And I think, why didn't that happen for me? for me? Why didn't God do that for me? God, why didn't you answer my prayer? And what I've learned is that when I start having the wrong feelings, when it should be a time of celebration and I'm like, this is grumpy, why didn't I get this? One is I realize I'm not in kindergarten anymore and it's time to mature a little bit. And you know what that does when I start feeling the wrong feeling? It's a trigger for me that says, okay, God, you got to do some business in my heart because this should be a time to celebrate and I'm jealous. And one of the things as disciples, as we grow and become more like Jesus, is we have to have the right emotions at the right situation. This is like parenting 101. This is what I've, my kids would come crying to me. Is this emotional, physical, and a new one we've added, biological? Because we have to understand why we're feeling what we're feeling. And sometimes we don't know why we're feeling what we're not feeling. And as we grow and become disciples of Jesus, we're accountable for our feelings. And when it's time to celebrate, do we celebrate with those that it's time to celebrate with? The scriptures are filled with this. The book of Ecclesiastes, there's a season. There's a time to celebrate. There's a time to cry. There's a time to mourn. Jesus speaks about this, is that we're to mourn with those who mourn. But we're also supposed to celebrate with those who celebrate. And part of what joy does is when we know it's time to party, we party. And many of us, we're missing that. We want joy in our lives, but we want all the good things to happen to us, but we don't know how to celebrate when something great happens to somebody else. We need to learn to be partiers, to celebrate when God does good things, not only in my life, but in those around us. And the enemy of our souls, I think this is where the enemy wants to rip us off so often, is when something good happens to somebody else. Here's my question. I get all consumed in me. What about me? They got a new truck. I want a new truck. When I was a child, I thought like a child. But I've put away childish things. We have to mature. Enjoy this gift of God. It has to be something we celebrate when it's time to celebrate. But this time, Zechariah, he's still not spoken. The baby's been born. And at the eighth day, they go and they present John at the temple. And they ask what his name should be. Zechariah can't speak. Elizabeth says his name will be John. And they're like, there's nobody in your family named John. We should name him Zechariah Jr. And they hand Zechariah a tablet. And he says, no, his name is John. And immediately when he writes that down, his tongue is loose, his speech comes back, and he begins to sing what is one of the historic songs of Christmas, or a praise, an exclamation of all that God has done. And here's part of it. He says, you are my child. You will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare a way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadows of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. And the child grew and became strong in spirit, and he lived in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel. And John becomes this amazing hero of the New Testament. He prepares the way for God. He's a prophetic messenger who changes the whole spiritual atmosphere of the nation of Israel. He begins to say, repent, for the kingdom of God is near. You need to be baptized. And people come out in droves, and thousands and thousands and thousands of people. I think it's hard for us to even grasp the popularity and the revolution that John brought. People were hungry. It birthed a spiritual hunger in these people that had never been there before. And day after day after day, John baptized thousands upon thousands of people, and it changed the atmosphere. And the whole nation, in preparation for the message of salvation, which Jesus was about to bring. And it changed everything. In John's life, this miracle child, he brought joy. His birth brought joy into the midst of his parents' barrenness. And he became a superstar in the nation. He didn't like get married and live in a quiet cul-de-sac. He lived out in the wilderness and ate funny things. But he was really famous. And he did these amazing things for God. And it brought great joy to Elizabeth and Zechariah. But this is a little bit of one of those dark stories in the scriptures. It's not a fairy tale ending. It starts in barrenness, comes to birth. And John's story ends with beheading. And John's this amazing guy. And here even Jesus, this is what Jesus says about John in Luke 7. He says, I tell you, among those born of women, there is no one greater than John. Yet the one who is least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. Jesus says that John, he's like the best human that's ever been born, naturally. Now, part of the kingdom of God, we can grow into that. And all the people, even the tax collectors, when they heard Jesus' words, acknowledged that God was the way was right because they had been baptized by John. And John's life and ministry and everything he did prepared the way for Jesus. He was amazing. He was a superstar. All these amazing things happen. But one day Herod, who was the ruler of that time, the Roman authority, he decided, hey, you know what? I'm not happy with my current wife. So I'm gonna divorce her and I'm gonna marry my brother's wife. And John, who's a person of influence and power, he speaks truth to power and he says, Herod, that's not good. That's unrighteous. And it causes tension and eventually Herod has John the Baptist thrown into prison. And one night, Herod, who's pursuing his happiness, it's his birthday, he's throwing a birthday party. He drinks a little too much. The daughter of his brother's wife, who he's now married, comes and performs in front of them. He's so pleased with her. He says, young woman, whatever you do, I'll give you up to half the kingdom because I'm so pleased with what you do. She runs out and finds her mom and says, what should I ask for? Could have been wealth, could have been power, could have been influence. Said, I want the head of John the Baptist who said that Herod marrying me was not good. So this girl runs back and says to her uncle, father, weird family dynamic. And says, I want John the Baptist's head on a platter. And Herod relents and he kills John the Baptist that very night. Story just has a dark ending. It's not like Christmas morning miracle. And it's hard to believe and it feels so out of control that some angry mom at a birthday party and an unwise drunk leader that divorced his wife and married his brother's wife can cause a lot of destruction and pain and sorrow in the world. And we don't know if Mary and Elizabeth were alive to see the death of their son. But pain and sorrow and grief. But true joy comes out of a story that ends in beheading. And here's what John says in John chapter 3 about himself. He says, you yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Messiah, but I am the one sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. And the friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine. And it is now complete. And then John's going to give us the secret to true joy. He must become greater and I must become less. This is what John says. If you really want to live a life of being a disciple of Jesus, if you really want to get it, what it means to follow Jesus, it is all about becoming less so Jesus can become more. And true joy comes from this. True joy comes from rejecting the culture's idea of happiness and pursuing the person of Jesus. True joy comes from rejecting the culture's ideas of happiness and pursuing the person of Jesus. In the first century, you think Herod would have had it, man. I don't like my wife, I'm going to get a new one. That'll make me happy. What does our culture tell us today? More is the secret to your happiness. More, 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 more. That is what our culture has always told us. In the kingdom of God, John gives us this idea, gives us this morsel of truth, which can so set us free. I must become less so he can become greater. The secret of godly joy, the secret of a God-filled life is about you becoming less and about Jesus becoming more.
Amen.
It's a hard message, but there's freedom. There's freedom, there's joy on the other side if we can really begin to get this. As we close, I'm gonna invite the band to make their way forward. We're gonna sing a song at the end, and we're gonna give. And I know for me and our family, last night we gathered around the table. And you know, one of the things that really fights this idea of more in me is being really generous. It has defined the people of God for a long time. Then in a culture that says more, 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 you know what the people of God do? Says, I'm gonna give, 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 give. I'm gonna be generous beyond what even makes sense sometimes. It defines God people, and I want it to be a thing that defines us. But can we pray before we sing? Lord, I know that in this room, those watching online, Lord, we long for happiness, we long for joy, we long for contentment, we long for all these amazing things. But even in the midst of our sorrow and joy and pain, there's hurt and there's grief and there's sorrow. And Lord, thank you that you meet us in the midst of our barren places, in the midst of grief, in the midst of sorrow. Lord, help us to never give up, to hold on. Because Lord, I don't know when you're gonna come through. I don't know if you're gonna come through. But help us to be righteous and blameless no matter what's going on. And then Lord, help us to have the secret of joy that we must become less so that you can become greater. Lord, thank you for the gift of joy. Thank you for the gift of your presence, that you're with us, Emmanuel, in the midst of any and every situation. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we said, we're going to receive a second offering. We do this only at Christmas. And so everything that's given today is going to go to the arrival here in this offering. If you didn't come prepared to give, our online store, our team has put together a great online store on our website. You can find the arrival, and there's a menu where you can pick all the things that you'd love to give towards. And I'm so excited and grateful that, hey, you know what? The secret is just having less and letting Jesus become more. This week, we sent 352 shoe boxes filled with Christmas gift to kids to Ukraine today on Thursday. Amen. Yeah, thank you for that. We bought 250 boxes and somehow God multiplied them by 102, and there's a bunch more that came in late. And you know what the miracle is? God provided all the shipping we needed for 100 extra boxes for kids. Nick and Yulia, who are there in Ukraine right now, we've been in communication with them. They're safe. There was a bunch of attacks the day after they got there, but they're gonna be distributing these gifts, which are gonna arrive here in these next couple days to kids who have been displaced. So thank you for your giving. Thanks for your generosity. And let's be a people that say, hey, I must become less so he, Jesus, can become greater. Ushers, will you make your way and will you lead us as we sing?
And joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven. Savior. joy, and He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of His righteousness and wonders of His love.
Stand together as we close. Oh, I pray that the light and the love of Jesus would fill your homes this week as we make our way to Christmas just in here in a few short hours, a few short days. Hey, we've got 5 Christmas candlelight services. It's a great opportunity to invite friends, family, neighbors. We've got cards all around the building. I'm really excited to celebrate. And we're going to look at this message of hope. Those of you who really have followed the Advent season, we messed the words up. We put them in a special order because I really feel that Christmas, we're going to focus on hope. What does it mean to be a people of hope? What does it mean to trust, to believe for something that we're longing for? I love you. I believe in you. If you need prayer, boy, we'd love for you to come up front and pray with us. I love our kids led us with giving. They're giving to chickens. Our high school kids are giving to build houses in Mexico. I love that God's stirring us from the top to the bottom. Hey, love you. Believe in you. Have a great week. You're dismissed. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. Hope to see you again real soon.
Chimneys too. It's Christmas.